Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Now we're glad to see you here in the auditorium in the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. May the Lord bless you. We appreciate the visitors that's visiting with us today. And you that's listening out in the radio listen audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, if you get on your phone and call a friend and have them to tune in and get this hour, we'll endeavor to be a blessing to them. You'll be doing them a favor. You'll be doing us a favor. And I hope you do that out there in the radio listening audience. Tell somebody about this good hour coming up so we can be a blessing to them. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping doing the song service that what Paul has lined up for us to be a blessing to our hearts. And then we'll preach to you what thus saith the Lord God. And we appreciate your presence here. We appreciate you listening in the radio listening audience. Now at this time, we'll turn the service to Paul. He'll direct the song service for us.
Get your hymnal, turn to page 288. Never Alone.
take your Bible, turn to John chapter 3, will you please? John chapter 3. Understand, out in California, in the past or some 30 years, there have been only one person put to death out there for committing cold-blooded murder. And the criminals out there have put to death, executed 30,000 innocent people in California. They have put to death 30,000 while the state has only put to death one. Our criminal judicial system today is in bad shape. It's rotten to the core. We don't have intestinal fortitude enough in the state of Georgia to put a man to death when he's sentenced to die. They don't have backbone enough to do it in other states. And for that reason, our precious, innocent, law-abiding citizens are dying every day. I understand now there's 11 stages in the state of Georgia when a man is sentenced to die, that he has a right to carry out or go through these 11 stages, which takes years to do so, not weeks, not months, but years. And then he has to go through the 11 stages if he desires to do so, even before they would consider putting him to death. That's rotten, that stinks to high heaven. And the people that put that on the books ought to be in the insane asylum someplace, and you're welcome. That's stupidity, that's a laughing stock to the world, of the world, in regard to our law, our judicial system here in the state of Georgia. And now in Atlanta, they're making a joke out of this Wayne Williams case. They'll make a joke and a laughing stock out of that. It's pathetic. I'm ashamed of the system in the state of Georgia. We need some politicians that's got backbone enough to try to get something done about it, to change the situation before multitudes and multitudes of our good people have to die by the hands of these criminals that should be put to death. They talk about having the prisons fill. They could very easily make more space and save a lot of money. That is the taxpayers' money if they'd go ahead and put to death those that have on death row now and quit acting a fool and playing around about it. But we don't have the intestinal fortitude enough to do it in the state of Georgia. And those in authority that can get it done and should get it done don't have any backbone. Now you turn, would you please, to John chapter 3. Let me read a few verses. In John chapter 3 and verse 3, Jesus answered and said unto them, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Look at the little verb be. He must be born again. He cannot born himself. Now we find in verse 7, "Marvel not, I said unto thee, you must be born again." Drop down, would you please, to verse 14. "And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God." Now last Sunday and Sunday before, I brought a message on the new birth. I want to bring that to conclusion here this morning. We saw several things about the new birth. We saw what the new birth is not. We dealt with it from that viewpoint. Then we saw what the new birth is, and we showed you how that is of God, entirely of God. You have no more to do with your second birth than you had to do with your first birth. It's the Holy Spirit. We saw the wind is irregular, so is the Holy Spirit. We saw the wind is invisible, so is the Holy Spirit. We saw the wind is inscrutable, so is the Holy Spirit. We saw the wind is indispensable, so is the Holy Spirit. And we saw the wind is invigorating, so is the Holy Spirit. Now we commented on that last Sunday morning. Now today, I want to talk about the how and simplicity of the new birth, and then what the new birth will do for you. And then if I have time, I want to give you three reasons why I believe that Nicodemus was truly born again according to the scriptures. Now let's notice the simplicity of the new birth. Remember that Jesus here is talking to an intelligent man, a religious leader, evidently a member of the Sanhedrin court, not a crackpot, but a man that was very intelligent and had followers of his own, no doubt, the man Nicodemus. Now Nicodemus knew something about the Old Testament scriptures, because Jesus said, "Now Nicodemus, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up." Now if you'll go back in the scriptures to Numbers chapter 21 and read verses 8 and 9, you see what I'm talking about. You'll find there that Moses, as he led God's people out of the Egyptian bondage across the Red Sea into the wilderness on toward the land of Canaan, they murmured and complained against Moses and Aaron, and God didn't like that, and God sent fiery serpents among them. The reason they were called fiery is because when they bit a man, it burned like fire. And there many of them became sickly, and many died, and they cried out to Moses. They said, "Sir, we want you to do something about this. We're sick, we're dying, we've been bitten by the serpent." The serpent here is a type of Satan and sin. And they were dying in a dying state, and they cried out for help. Moses cried to God about what to do. And God said, "Moses, take some brass. Out of that brass, form a serpent." Brass is symbolic of God's judgment. Form a serpent, which is a type of a curse. The Bible said, "Curses everyone that hangeth on a tree," and they crucified Jesus, as you know. And then there, of course, he formed that serpent, and God said, "Now, Moses, take that serpent, place it on a pole, and lift it up high, and tell those people, if they will behold that serpent, if they believe what you tell them, and behold that serpent, they can be healed immediately." That's exactly what Moses did. Now, remember here that Jesus is illustrating the new birth to Nicodemus. He knew that Old Testament story. He knew what Moses did. He knew what they did, the people did. How they were healed, they were made whole by believing the man of God and beholding that brazen serpent, which is the type of Jesus hanging on the cross. He didn't stop there. He went on and said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him should not perish but have everlasting life." And there Jesus was given, and there he was hanged on a cross, taken down and buried. After 72 hours, he came out of that grave and later ascended back to heaven. He said, "Now, Nicodemus, you must believe that. You must believe on me. You must believe that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth," not whosoever feeleth, not whosoever willeth. The Bible says, "Not of him that will or him that runneth, it's of God, whosoever believeth." You must believe in order to be saved. Now you can will to be saved and die and go to hell. You can work to be saved and die and go to hell. Beloved, you must repent of your sins and believe on Jesus Christ if you expect to be saved. Amen. Whosoever believeth, believeth, believeth. Now you must hear that and hear it well. And so he said, "God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son," and that was Jesus Christ, of course, "that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." He was talking here to a very intelligent man, illustrating by the serpent in the wilderness, comparing that with Jesus on the cross, and Nicodemus could see very easily what he was saying. So that's the simplicity of the new birth. It's a matter of repeating and believing on Jesus. Not of good works, not by keeping the law, not by abiding some golden rule, but believing on Jesus Christ, receiving him by faith into your heart, and God does the job. Now remember, if you were never born the second time, you'd have been better off if you'd never been born the first time. I was born the first time out here in Madison County, between Danielsville and Coma, Georgia, in a little community called the Bullock's Mill Community. I was born the second time yonder in the city of Greenville, South Carolina. Had I never been born the second time, I'd have been far better off not to have been born the first time. There's multitudes in hell today saying, "I would to God that I'd never been born. I would to God that I've never been born. If you die and go to hell, whether you be here in this auditorium or out in the radio listening audience, if you die and go to hell, you begin to scream with millions of others in hell saying, I would to God I had never been born. So it's imperative that you be born the second time, or you'll never see nor enter into the kingdom of God. Now let's find out what the new birth will do for you. Number one, the new birth will make you love God. Now, if you are not saved, you don't love God. Don't tell me you love God if you are not saved. You don't. It's impossible for you to love God if you are unsaved, because the Bible said the love of God is shed abroad in your heart by the Holy Ghost. Only saved people love God. Sinners do not love God. Now, beloved, your idea, your efforts at enmity with God, not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. And the only people that love God today are those that's been born the second time by the Word of God and the Spirit of God. In 1 John chapter 5 and verse 1, the Bible said, whosoever believeth that Jesus Christ is born of God. And everyone that loveth him that begat loveth him also that is begotten of him. So the love of God must come into your heart after you're born again. Then you love the Lord. As I grew up in my family, the Edwards family, I began to love my mother and daddy because I had been born into that family. I did not love God until I was saved. I knew nothing about God. I was not disrespectful toward God. I tried not to be, to say things that I thought like blasphemy or so forth, because I just didn't really want to do that. But I didn't know anything about God because I'd never been saved. But when God saved me, I began to love the Lord. And so the Bible says then you'll love God. Secondly, you will love God's children. When you're born again, you'll love God's children. You cannot hate God's people, God's children, and then say that you're saved. There's something wrong. You must love the people of God. You might not like my looks. You might not like the way I do things. But if you're saved, deep down in your heart, you love me because I belong to God and you belong to God. We're all in the same family. And so you love God's children. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 5, verse 2, by this we know that we love the children of God when we love God. And so you love God's people. We might not agree on everything we do, but we love each other as the people of God. There's something on the inside of us that makes us love each other. I had no use for the people of God before God saved me. I didn't want them around me. In fact, if they came around me, I was miserable. But after God saved me, that made the difference. That's the group I started searching for and fell at home with, because I fell at home with them because I also had been born into that great family. Not only will it make you love God's children, but the second birth will make you love your Bible. This is the greatest book in all the world. This is the blessed book. This is the book I love. It's food to my soul. It blesses my heart. Sometimes I begin to study this book yonder in my study, and God begins to cause my heart to burn within me, and I begin to praise God. There's something about that book that you find no other book like it. It is the book of God. And if you're saved, you will love this blessed book. Not only that, you won't be ashamed of this blessed book. That's why every one of you ought to bring your Bible to church. Don't be ashamed of the Word of God. Dwight L. Moody said the greatest sermon he ever saw with his eyes was a man walking down the street with a Bible under his arm. When you come to God's house, bring that book. Bring God's Bible. Bring the Bible, the Word of God, to the house of God with you. It's a great testimony. And when the preacher stands up to read the text, turn in your Bible and follow him in the Scriptures. When he gives you other verses, follow him in the Word of God. See whether or not he's preaching, thus saith the Lord God. Not only that, but number four, it'll put you in the family of God. The new birth will place you in the family of God. You are not God's child until you're born into that family by a spiritual birth. The Bible says in John chapter 1 that he came unto his own, and his own received him not. But to as many as receive him, them gave he power to become the sons of God, even them that believe on his name. And he goes on to say, which is born of God. So you see then, the moment you're born again, by the word and by the spirit, you become a child of God. You're part of the great family of God. As a man of God preaches the word of God, which is the seed of God, the Holy Spirit of God takes the seed of God, the word of God. He plants that in the womb of your heart. As you repent and believe, the Holy Ghost quickens you and births you into the family of God. It is a birth by God's Spirit and by God's word. Water baptism has nothing to do with it. Reformation or education has nothing to do with it. It's an act of God, quickened by the Spirit of God. The moment you repent of your sins, take your place before God as a lost sinner, like the Philippian jailer. Take your place before God, a sinner that cannot save yourself, deserving to go to hell, should have been in hell a long time ago, and yet through God's mercy you get alive, and just say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Receive him by faith, believe in him. Right then, you will he quickened by the Holy Spirit the moment that you take your place before God, repent and believe. There you're born into the family of God. Not only that, but according to the Bible, the moment you're born again, you receive a new nature, a divine nature. That's imparted to you a divine nature. And then, after that second birth, you have a dual nature. You have the Adamic and you have the divine. Now, until you're born the second time, you don't have that divine nature. You only have the Adamic nature. But when you're born into the family of God, then you have the divine placed in there with the Adamic, and there you have a dual nature. If you follow after the Adamic, you're going to walk in the lust of the flesh. If you follow after the divine, you'll walk in the spirit. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, you become a new creature in Christ. Old things pass away, but all things become new. That doesn't mean the Adamic is annihilated. It's not. The Adamic nature will be with you as long as you remain in this body. But you also have a divine nature in there that can give the upper hand over the Adamic, and you can walk in the Spirit. That's what he's talking about in the book of Galatians, where he said the Spirit against the flesh against the Spirit. That was an Indian one time that just recently been saved, and he went to the market to buy some corn, some seed corn, and there the man sold him some seed corn. And by accident, whenever the Indian paid for the corn, the owner placed that money back in the bag with the corn, and the Indian went home. And of course, the man didn't know he had done that, and neither did the Indian until he arrived back home. He pulled out his corn, and lo and behold, there was his money in the same bag. He didn't know what to do about it. He thought, well, I could very well keep that, and the merchant wouldn't know it, and I'd have my corn and my money. Oh, he said, I could take it back. He had just been saved, and that night he couldn't sleep very well. And he got up early the next morning. He took that money. He went back to the man from whom he had purchased the corn. He said, sir, I want to bring some money back to you. You gave me through a mistake. It's not mine. It right belongs to you. He said that there's two men on the inside of me, and they won't let me rest. Said all night long, one of them said, you keep that money. They'll never know anything about it. They're at the market. The other said, you better get up and take it back because God knows about it, and you better carry that money back. And he said, all night long, these two men fought. They fought. They battled. I didn't sleep because they kept on fighting all night. The only way I can stop them is to bring the money back. And he carried the money back, and then one of them had to shut up. Beloved, listen, you have a dual nature. You have the Spirit of God in you. You're still in the Adamic body, and there's a battle going on. If you follow the Spirit, God will bless you and use you. If you follow after the flesh, you cannot be used and blessed of God. So you have that dual nature. Not only that, it assures you for heaven. You just as certain to go to heaven if you have been born the second time as you're sitting there in that pew, or as you listen to me out in the radio listening audience. Oh, you may say, now preach Edwards, just suppose I decide to cuss out loud, buy another bottle of beer, you think I'll go to heaven? Well, if you're a God's child, what are you thinking about that in the first place for? You need to be thinking about the Bible, The Word of God is serving God. You didn't have anything to do with your second birth nor your first birth. And since you're in God's family, you need to serve the Lord. And you should have desire to serve God. If you don't have a desire to serve God, there's something wrong. You better check up. You might not be saved. There's some of you Baptist people sitting out there in the radio listening audience. You know you ought to be in God's house. Do you know you're saved? If you didn't have a desire to be in God's house today, you may not be saved. I'm not saying you. I say you may not. You need to check up about that. From time God saved me, when they opened that church door, unless I was sick and God's been good to me, very little time have I ever had to stay out of church because of sickness. Thank God, I give Him the glory and the praise and the credit. I was right there in the house of God. And when they opened the doors that night, I was right back there. When they had a Wednesday night prayer meeting, I was right there. I wanted to be there. I felt better in the house of God than I felt sitting at home. That's where God's people ought to be. If they're physically able, they ought to be in the house of God, worshiping God. On a beautiful day like this, unless you're sick, aged, or providentially hindered, you ought to be in the house of God. Whether you like me telling you so or not, you ought to be there. It'll assure you for heaven, it'll give you victory over the world. In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4, you of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is He that's in you than he that's in the world. If you are born the second time, you have in you the Spirit of God. And the Bible says, He that's in you is greater than the he that's in the world. The Holy Ghost in you is greater than the world and the devil. You can be victorious. You don't have to live a defeated life. There's no excuse to live a defeated life. You don't have to be overcome by this world. The Bible said, are you listening? Listen to me, hear me, and hear me well. He that's in you is greater than he that's in the world. If you want to live for God, you can live for God. No excuse you're not living for God. You may say, preacher, I have persecution, I've faced this, that, and well. The Bible said you can live for God if you want to. There's no temptation taking you, but such as common man, that God is faithful, will not lie to be tempted but able, but will with that temptation make a way of escape. Now let's move on. I'm going to give you three reasons why I believe that Nicodemus understood what Jesus is talking about, and why I believe Nicodemus really got saved or born again that night. Number one, Nicodemus came to Jesus. In John chapter 3 and verse 2, the same came to Jesus by night. That's the only way he could come. Darkness within, corresponding with darkness without, he came at night. He had darkness within, darkness without. Came in spiritual darkness. Came to Jesus that night. And that's the only way any sinner can come to God. That is, you have darkness within. You need the light. God is that light. That's the way sinners come to God. In Matthew chapter 11 and verse 28, Jesus said, come to me, all ye laboring, heavy laden, and I will give you rest. To whom did Nicodemus come? He came to Jesus. What did Jesus say? Come to me, all ye labor and heavy laden, I'll give you rest. In John chapter 6 and verse 37, Jesus said, all the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. I appreciate that. God said, if any poor little sinner, if anyone would come to him, mean business, God said, I'll in no wise cast you out. Nicodemus came to Jesus. Not only that, he came as a little child. And Jesus said, unless you come as a little child, you'll in no wise enter in. And that's the way he came. So we find midnight when he came to him the first time. When he came to Jesus, it was midnight. Secondly, we find the twilight. That is, he confessed Christ with his mouth. In John chapter 7, verses 50 and 51, Nicodemus saith unto them, he that came to Jesus by night, being one of them, doth our Lord judge any man before we hear him and know what he doeth? Here we find Nicodemus standing up for Jesus. He stood up for one whom the rulers had condemned. His own crowd had condemned Jesus. And here in John chapter 7, verses 50 and 51, he stood up and confessed Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 10 and verse 10, with the mouth confessing made unto salvation. So number one, Nicodemus came to Jesus. Number two, he confessed Christ with his mouth. Number one, it was midnight. Number two, it was twilight. Now let's take a look at the daylight. He had a faith that works. In John chapter 19 and verse 39, then came also Nicodemus, which at the first came to Jesus by night, and brought a mixture of myrrh and aloe, about 100 pound weight. Here we find a man working for God. He had come to Jesus. He stood up and confessed Jesus, and now he's working for God. James said in James 2:26, for as a body without the spirit is dead, faith without works is also dead. Beloved, listen, I believe in a faith that works. You show me a man that says he's saved and never does anything for God, no concern about the things of God, I'll point you out a man that's been deceived. There's something wrong. He just thinks he's saved. Because if a man is saved, he wants to do something for God. He loves the Lord. He's concerned about spiritual things. A dead corpse cannot have a desire to eat or do anything. But a man that's alive can have a desire. And if you have been made alive by the Spirit of God and the Word of God, then you have desire to do something for the Lord. So Nicodemus came to Jesus, confessed Jesus, and worked for Jesus. And I believe when we get to heaven, we'll find this man on the other side. This and I close. Several years ago in a town about 30 miles from here, I ran a tent meeting. We had a good revival. In those days, you could put up a tent and have at least 100 people to make a profession of faith. And so we ran the tent meeting. There's a dear lady in this meeting. She came every night and brought a pitcher of water. I said to my music director at that time, I said, Bill, I believe that woman is a real fine woman. Don't you think so? He said, I believe so. And she came every night, smile on her face. Her husband got saved during the tent meeting, and so her children, a couple of children got saved. We left that town later, and I closed out my tent meeting in Greenville, South Carolina. We had our last meeting for the year there. But before we went to Greenville, we placed our tent up in another town about 40 miles from here. And on Saturday night, I believe it was the last Saturday night of the meeting, this person came and visited us in this meeting. I preached that night on the new birth. I noticed this person sat there, very quiet, and seemed to be disturbed. And after we dismissed, this person left the tent meeting and went back home without having spoken to us. I said to my wife, I said, what's wrong with Mrs. So-and-so? I said, she's usually very friendly, and she didn't even speak to us. You think maybe she might have a feeling hurt? She said, I don't know. But I noticed she listened very attentively that night. A few weeks later, are you listening? A few weeks later, after closing out the tent meeting over in Greenville, I received a letter from this dear lady. And she begins right. She said, preach, Edward, you'll be surprised as you read this letter. Said, when I came to hear you preach on the new birth, and she named the place, said, you preached that night on the new birth. Said, I listened. And said, preach, Edward, you'll be shocked at this. So I've been a good woman all my life. I was a good girl, came up in a good family, and I even attended church and did a lot of religious things. And said, Preacher Edwards, I was faithful in your meeting in this town. And she mentioned the town. And she said, you'll be shocked when I tell you this. Said, I realized for the first time in my life, when you preached that sermon on the new birth, that I'd never been born again. She said, I went back home miserable. So that's why I didn't speak to you and Ms. Edwards. I went home miserable. I couldn't go to sleep. I went to bed. I couldn't sleep. She said, preach, it was at 3 o'clock the next morning. I got on my knees and repented and believed on Jesus with all my heart. And I was born again. Praise the Lord. Oh, listen, dear people. Do you know that you know you've been born again? You can be religious and still go to hell. You need to know that you've been born into the family of God. Let's stand to our feet. Father, I pray today you'll take the message and use it to thy glory. May thy name be honored. May Jesus be glorified. God, I pray today that you'll use the message not only here in the auditorium, but may it reach out in the radio listening audience. May something be accomplished today, Father, be everlasting. Oh, my God, may something be accomplished in the hearts of someone today, that when we come to the end of life's journey, we can realize something has been accomplished this day. God, I pray for everyone in this building and those in the radio listening audience in Jesus' name. Amen.